false color count, 543.
Thank you.
213. 213, because he lives.
Two what?
213. God save his son.
And all in Jesus. He can do it. He can do it. He lives in God. Through my life, Lord. And if he raises it, through my Savior. Because he lives. trumpets will sound, and all of the dead shall rise, righteous made in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward
bound. Amen.
We stand with ourselves.
Praise God.
For this morning's sermon can be found in Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13, and we'll start in verse 31, and we'll read through the end of the chapter. Mark 13, starting in verse 31, and it reads, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But of that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but the Father alone. Take heed, keep on the alert, for you do not know when the appointed time is. It is like a man away on a journey, who upon leaving his house and putting his slaves in charge, assigning to each one his task, also commanded the doorkeeper to stay on the alert. Therefore, be on the alert, for you do not know when the master of the house is coming, whether in the evening, at midnight, at cock crowing, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, be on the alert."
Studying from Mark chapter 13 for quite a while. Going to finish that up this morning. Chapter starts with the disciples commenting on the beautiful buildings in the temple. And Jesus responds to their comment with a shocking prediction that the temple is going to be completely destroyed, which was unthinkable to the disciples at that time. So the disciples ask, well, when are these things going to be? And in Matthew, records, they also ask, what is the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? And Jesus' response to their question is chapter 13 of Mark, known as the Olivet Discourse. He makes many prophecies, and he offers sound advice, actually commands, on how to follow him in the midst of some very troubling times. There are many prophecies in this chapter. Some have clearly already happened. Verse 2 of Mark chapter 13, Jesus said to them, or to him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another which will not be torn down." Well, this happened in 70 AD. Some of the prophecies are clearly in the future. In verse 24 through 26, Jesus said, "In those days after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. And the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers that are in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory." Obviously, this has not happened yet. And then some of the prophecies Jesus made are happening now. if you read verse 7 and 8 of this chapter, it's like listening to last night's or tonight's news. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. Do not be frightened. Those things must take place. That is not yet the end. For nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will also be famines. These are things are merely the beginnings of birth pangs. Now, I can't give you all the details of when each prophecy is or will be fulfilled, and that's the point of our study this morning. Jesus, I don't think, meant for us to have all the details, but he did make clear to us things that he wants us to know for sure. For example, in verse 5, he's very clear. He says, "See to it no one misleads you." And the way that we can avoid being misled is staying in God's word. In verse 7, he said, "Don't be frightened." In verse 9, he said, "Be on your guard." In verse 11, "Do not be anxious." The way we can avoid being frightened and anxious is trust God and keep our walk with him up. In verse 23, he says, "Take heed." Verse 33, he says, "Take heed, be on the alert." In verse 35, he says, "Be on the alert." In verse 37, he says, "Be on the alert." This morning, we're going to focus on the end of this chapter, verses 32 to 37, where in five verses, he tells us three times to be on the alert. I think that's his main point, is be on the alert. We also know for sure Jesus is letting us know about tough times his disciples will face. Verse 10 tells us the gospel will be preached to all nations. And we see from verse 20 and 23 his protection and care for us to prepare us for what is to come. And we also know from verse 31, heaven and earth will pass away, but God's word will not pass away. I think there's great danger if we try to start trying to pinpoint when all of these prophecies are going to happen or when they've occurred. If you look at verse 32, it says, "Of that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but the Father alone." Jesus specifically tells us, no one knows the day or the hour except the Father. Which brought up an interesting question as I studied this. Jesus says he doesn't know. But if he's God, how could he not know what God knows when all these things take place? And God's a little beyond my comprehension. I don't claim to know the definitive answer to that question. But we do get some clues from Scripture. If you look in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 7, it says, "Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, though he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men." It's hard for me to understand exactly what happened when Jesus, the Son of God, became a man. I know it doesn't mean he quit being God. He is God. But it says he emptied himself. He laid aside his privileges and his advantages as God and laid aside some of his prerogatives of his deity. He didn't stop being omniscient. He's God. He just didn't use that attribute in taking the form of a bondservant, being made in the likeness of men. Very similar. He laid aside his omnipresence while he was in bodily form. But Jesus' point here is that no one here can tell us the day and the hour of the Lord's return. But there is a specific day and hour. We know he is returning. From God's perspective, Jesus' first coming, his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his second coming are all part of what the Bible calls the last days. We've been living in the last days for quite a while, and we don't know how much longer they'll last. Some of the descriptions and the prophecies make it seem like it's very close. I believe it's very close. But like looking at the mountains from the valley, it's hard or impossible to tell how close. Some days, not last week, but some days, they look so close that you feel like you could almost reach out and touch them. But there's actually quite a distance. What we know for sure is that he is coming back, and we need to be ready. And that's the major point of this passage of scripture this morning in Mark chapter 13. Verse 33 says, "Take heed, keep on the alert, for you do not know when the appointed time is." Our ignorance of the time is not an excuse to be unprepared. It's an incentive for us to stay on task. Verses 34 through 37, I'm going to read again. It says, "It's like a man away on a journey who, upon leaving his house and putting his slaves in charge, assigning to each one his task, also commanded the doorkeeper to stay on the alert. Therefore, be on the alert. You do not know when the master of the house is coming, whether in the evening, at midnight, at cockcrowing, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, be on the alert." We don't know when he will return, so we need to keep doing what we're supposed to be doing so that we will be doing it when he does return. We need to stay faithful. Notice in verse 34, everyone has a task. We aren't here by accident. God has a purpose for each one of us. And if we're faithful in obedience, we will be doing what we're supposed to be doing when he does return. In Matthew chapter 25, which Jacob read earlier today, we find the parable of the 10 virgins who went out to meet the bridegroom. The 5 foolish ones took no oil with them. 5 prudent ones had oil. I believe the oil represents the Holy Spirit who God gives us when we trust Jesus as our Savior. When the bridegroom came, the foolish ones were not ready, and the bridegroom, who they call Lord, said, "I don't know you." They had tried to get oil from the others. It didn't happen. You can only get your salvation from Jesus. You can't get it from someone else. You have to have your own faith in Jesus, Savior. So in being prepared for the Lord's return, trusting Christ to save you is the first thing. Jesus, the Son of God, died on the cross to take the penalty for our sin. He was buried. He rose again. He's alive today. And he offers salvation and forgiveness of our sin to all who trust him. The Bible says no one comes to God except by believing in Jesus, which is obviously the first important step in being ready for Jesus' return. Matthew chapter 7, verse 22 and 23, Jesus said, "Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" These people that Jesus is talking about went to church, they did religious things, but if they never trusted Christ for salvation, and if Jesus says, "I never knew you," I would call that being unprepared for his coming. We need to make sure our faith is in Jesus to save us and not in any of our own efforts to be good enough for him. So even though we don't know exactly when Jesus is coming, we do know for sure that he is, and that's the incentive for us to stay faithful to our tasks. In Matthew 24, Jesus said, verses 42 to 51, Jesus said, "Therefore be on the alert. You do not know which day your Lord is coming. But be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known at what time of the night the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. For this reason, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will. Who then is the faithful and sensible slave whom his master put in charge of his household to give them their food at the proper time? Blessed is that slave whom his master finds so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But if that evil slave says in his heart, 'My master is not coming for a long time,' and begins to beat his fellow slaves and eat and drink with the drunkards, The master of that slave will come on a day when he does not expect him, at an hour which he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus, in this passage, gives us some clues of how to stay faithful to our task, and some clues as to what it looks like if we don't. In verses 45 to 47, we see the positive. We see a faithful, sensible, obedient servant. And in 46, it says the master finds him doing what he's supposed to be doing when he comes. And verse 47 tells us there's a reward for that. And then in verses 48 to 51 of this passage, we see the negative. It's easy to say, I've been hearing about Jesus' return all my life, but I haven't seen it. And then ignore the fact that he is returning. Because it's been a long time from a human perspective, it is very easy to adopt that attitude. And I think that's why Jesus tells us so many times, take heed, stay on the alert, because it's so easy to get complacent. The result of a complacent attitude in this passage in Matthew, we see in verse 49, he says, I'm going to forget about serving God. I'm going to serve others and do what I want. I'll serve the Lord later. We see the result of that attitude in verse 50 and 51. The point of staying alert is just be about the Lord's business as a habit of your life. God's given us all gifts and abilities, and for the purpose of serving Him, for serving others, and doing our part to build God's kingdom. Each one of us have jobs to do for God's kingdom that no one else can do. We live our lives like Jesus' return is a long time away. Faithful and sensible, but stay prepared like it's today. We got to find that balance between agitation where, oh, he's coming back this week or today. Let's sell everything and go to the mountain and wait for him. That's one side. The other side is stagnation. That's a long time away. I'll just do what I want for a few years, and then a little while, I'll get ready for his coming later. Jesus is telling us, stay ready, so he doesn't come back and find us asleep or unprepared. If there's time before Jesus returns, it's for us to do the work of the kingdom while we wait. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. The Lord's patiently waiting, giving people an opportunity to repent. And this time gives us opportunities to share the gospel. Augustine said, he who waits the coming of the Lord is not he who says it's really near, or he who says it's really far, but he who, whether it's near or far, awaits it with all his heart. Alistair Begg pointed out a good illustration of staying alert. When Jesus was on the cross, they offered him an anesthesia, and Jesus refused it at that time. And the result was he was awake to tell the thief that he was saved. Jesus stayed alert. So there is a definite day and time when Jesus will return. We don't know when, but it is a certainty. Jesus tells us to be alert, stay ready. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 4 through 8. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day would overtake you like a thief. For you are all sons of light and sons of day. We're not of night or darkness, so let us not sleep as others do. Let us be alert and sober. For those who sleep do their sleeping at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we are of the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. And 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 to 13. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. Since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be destroyed by burning, and the elements will melt with intense heat? But according to his promise, we're looking for a new heaven, a new earth, in which righteousness dwells. Our response, be sure of our faith in Christ, be faithful in obedience to the tasks he's given us. J. Vernon McGee was talking about this very thing this week on the radio. He was teaching from 2 Thessalonians, but he mentioned three W's. Stay in the Word, mind your walk with God, and be faithful in your works. Well, it's kind of helped me to remember the three things there that help us to be ready, stay ready for the Lord's return. The whole chapter of Mark 13 should encourage us when we look around, the world seems out of control. Jesus told us in advance what would happen so we would not freak out and be afraid. He is in control of human history. This is not a surprise to him. He will return and make things right, and there will be judgment. I want to close with teaching from two of the guys who heard this message from Jesus firsthand. John and Peter were guys that asked the question of Jesus in the first place, in verse 4, and they heard the answer. And here's how they taught us. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3, John says, "See how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God, and such we are. For this reason, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is. And everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure." So John says our response, purify ourselves just as he is pure. And 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter says in verse 3 through 9, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Because of Jesus' resurrection, which Peter was an eyewitness, we know he's returning, even if we don't know when. We can live daily in this living hope, staying alert, being faithful and sensible in our service to God. And because of our faith in Jesus, obtaining as the outcome of our faith the salvation of our souls." Let's pray. Lord, thanks for your word. Thank you for your care for us. Thank you that you told us about these things that are coming to prepare us. Some of them seem a little unsettling, but we know that we can trust you, that we have your assurance that you're going to bring us through it. Thank you that you told us how to be prepared. Help us to remember that you are in control, and that help us to stay alert and live obedient lives for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's close with "The King Is Coming," number 238. Jesus in prayer.
Our Father, I just thank you that you are coming and that we can have a glorious future because we know you. God, help us to go out and proclaim that word so others can have hope and a future too. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.